Okay, events are unfolding with extreme rapidity right now, so I'm going to continue to stay on top of this. It's quite extraordinary. Something just occurred to me today. I did a little calculation. Now, to set the stage, take September 15th. There's a number of very important issues taking place on September 15th. I believe it's the end of Jade Helm. It's the start of the 70th UN Council, which the Pope is going to address, I believe, on his visit to the United States. September 15th, very important day. I was just given a date today in an interesting way. Talking about the 14th, up until the 14th, something about that, and then on the 15th, okay, some issue. Now, if we start after the 15th, so after the 15th, let us say that this is Conception Day of the New World Order, starting on the 16th, okay, if we, what is Conception? 280 days, right? So, if we add 280 days to the 16th, we arrive at June 21st, 216, which is the last day I've said that we have to be ready. And that after that date, starting on the 22nd, we better be done before June 22nd, I said. Or maybe I said by, but I mean by or before. Let's put it that way. 280 days takes us right to the 22nd. Let's put it that way. It takes us right to June 22nd from September 15th, which is gestation, all right, which is birth. So these, whoever is, you know, the egos behind it, but we say the Illuminati and all these different secrets, whatever's going on, the elites, they love symbolism. They do everything with numbers and symbology and everything. Well, coming back from June 22nd, 280 days would take us back to the 16th, if we took it as the 21st to the 16th. So that means that this period, I was told we have up to the 14th to prepare, perhaps. Interesting. So from the 15th then, we have all this stuff going, taking place, and the Pope arriving on the 22nd, meeting with the President 23rd, addressing Congress on the 24th. So I feel that we are, and there's apparently there's a lot of movies and popular culture that has targeted September 23rd, talking about possible catastrophes, false flags. There's a ton of information out there talking about September that I think it's worth us at least being aware of this. Now, I've been alerted that this is very important month that we're in right now. So, but we want to look at the forest instead of the trees. We want to get the overall layout. This is how I work. I work with the abstract mind, big picture. Not getting lost in detail. So I tend to maybe mention them, but yeah, in passing, you know, I don't want to nail anything down too much. There's occasional details, but this gestation period, I think, is very, very relevant because the Holy Spirit told me that we need to be done by June 22nd, 216 in our preparation. We want to be very far along at that point in peace of mind, towards enlightenment. So the fact that a full gestation period for birth would take us right back then to the 16th means that the 15th could be a day that is very heavily targeted as Conception Day for the New World Order. And this may get attention upon, you know, the Pope and the President. And so it's heavy duty. And I remember back in 2004, I was told that I have to wait until 2015, and then there'll be a sudden clearing that I took meaning of my mind or something like that. There will be some very big enlightenment event. I don't know if it's just me or the planet, but you know, we will see. But it's 2:15 for sure. So the 15th of September, maybe this is a very crucial day. Now, what to do about it? Well, we're in luck here, because there's rapid progress within my mind and understanding, and maybe within yours too. I'm starting to see what is possible. Really, really, I'm pushing as fast as I can right now. So I realize that something really is up. Really is up. There is an enormous amount of dynamic right now in the world. Okay, extraordinary dynamic. And I know there's all these conspiracy websites are talking about, but I'm interested in what we can do in terms of our peace of mind. And what I've been working on is to use a financial analogy with stocks. I would say let us divest ourselves of the stocks of thoughts. Look at thinking and thoughts as stock that we've invested in. And I would say, as a wise stockbroker, I'd say, you know what, it's time to play it safe. Let's sit on the sidelines of the stock market right now and divest ourselves of thought. Okay, now we're talking about, well, how can we sit on the sidelines? I know we have to sidestep the situation that's arising in the world. Does it mean going to another planet, going to another dimension? I don't know, but here's one simpler explanation for it, which is divest ourselves of the stock of thoughts. Okay, and the reactions of thoughts, the motions and reactions, which are reactions of thoughts and thinking. Divest ourselves of that. And this would be analogous to sitting on the sidelines of the stock market. Said, you know what? I think I want to divest myself of stocks and put it in T-bills or in the bank or some, you know, much safer location. I want my investment, my nest egg, to be in a much safer location than stocks. So what we could do is say, I want to put my peace of mind, my mental investment, in a much more stable investment than thoughts right now. Now, the reason we can give for this, and by the way, we'll say, you know what, I want to sit out this next 9 months or so, and then I'll reevaluate my investment portfolio in after June 22nd. We can say this is something that people understand. We can modernize the language a little bit here. All right, so this is, I'm going quickly here, but I'm going to slow down just a little bit. Now, what we will say is that we feel that the stock market of thoughts is possibly rigged. We feel it's a very volatile time, is possibly rigged, and there's a lot, way too much recklessness going on in the world. We feel that there's an attitude of overconfidence and recklessness, so similar to like the dot-com boom. You know how much, of course, I was living in the Silicon Valley my whole life. I was here during the entire dot-com situation and, you know, walking the streets and experiencing it all. It was absolutely crazy. The amount of overconfidence here by these Generation Xers or whatever they were at the time was absolutely astonishing. I mean, we thought pretty much we had ascended into a new world. I mean, this area. I mean, it was just, you know, like funny money. It was crazy. And then I predicted the bust of that dot-com era. And quite a few people did. But I was certainly telling people, this is going to collapse, believe me. It was like the tulip media or something. So the tech people have a tendency to be overconfident to the point of extreme recklessness. So this is what I feel the world is going to, an extraordinarily reckless phase of great overconfidence. And, you know, it's a way of saying, hey, I think the market is too volatile right now. The market of thoughts and ideas in the, you know, worldly market. I'm going to put my money in a safer place. I'm going to put my, you know, investment in my being in a different place right now. All right? And take it out of the thoughts. So that'd just be a wise investment strategy. This is a way to look at it. And so then I was able to get a mental picture of how this would happen. And I saw myself sitting like in a beautiful landscape countryside, and there were some mountains in the distance, not super far distance, but let's say about maybe 10 miles away or so. And the fields turned into some hills and it turned into mountains. And where the mountain was, there were some clouds, okay, by the mountaintop where clouds tend to precipitate, form, you know, like near mountaintops because of the price of the air and the cooling off of it. And the cloud was just kind of, you know, how clouds move and form like this. They're always sort of changing like this. And what it really was it was a cloud of thoughts. A cloud of thoughts. My thoughts. You call them my thoughts. We call them like this cloud of my thoughts. But all the rest of the sky was clear. I was just sitting in this beautiful field and just gorgeously clear. And I said, okay, my thoughts are over there. My thoughts are over by the mountaintop there. And that's fine. I'll just let them stay there. They're not going anywhere. And I'm just going to stay here. And that's it. Now, I'm not really paying any attention to the shape the cloud is taking, really. And it's constantly changing shape. I said, it really doesn't matter to me, you know, what shape it is in, does it? I'm not invested in it right now. I'm not invested in the thought cloud at this point. But it's still there. So the cloud of thoughts is still there. I'm just not identified with it. I'm not paying attention to it so much. So I just had this idea that this is something we could do. Something like this. Imagine yourself sort of like that. We don't have to have the sky perfectly clear. No thoughts anywhere. That's probably too scary for us. It's just that they're just sort of a cloud off there in the periphery. That's just staying there. We don't have to go examine it. We don't have to hike to the mountaintop and, you know, pay attention to the clouds so much. We might glance at it sometimes and just say, oh, okay, those are my thoughts, whatever. Those are just thoughts reacting, getting reactions from one another. Of course, the purpose of those thoughts is simulating a reaction in God, which there is no reaction. God has no reaction. So it doesn't really matter what kind of simulated reaction my thoughts come up with, ultimately, does it? But it's kind of comfortable to still have the thoughts hanging around at a distance like that. So we could do something like that. That would be very easy to do, actually, once we get the mental picture of it. So this, the Holy Spirit just brought this to my attention. So how about this? Just it's time to disinvest in your thought cloud for a while, and we'll re-examine it at June 22nd, 2016. Seems like a wise thing to do. It seems like there is likely to be great volatility in the world. In many ways, some may be very unexpected. So why not play it safe? Why not play it safe? Instead of being immersed in our thought cloud and react, you know, being our mind like looking at all these reactions of our thoughts, you know, the reaction complex that we have. Why not just put that reaction complex off to the side at some distance? And you just, you know, don't have any thoughts at all in that way at all. You just are abiding in this beautiful ambience, just enjoying, peaceful and happy. Another idea arose earlier in the day, which is, you know, taking refuge in this mental state that we have access to. We can do this where there's no advantage to me. I'm not going to gain any advantage in the next 9 months, let's say. I'm not going to gain any advantage, but I'm also not going to suffer any disadvantage whatsoever. So it's kind of a neutral state. I'm neither gaining nor am I losing. Very safe, kind of a safe investment condition where it's sort of like you take all your money out of the market and say, well, I'm not going to even get any interest at all on it. So yeah, I may lose out on some, you know, big advantage of making a lot of money, but also I'm not going to lose any of it. Now this seems like might be a very smart way to go, because it could be that the next nine months may seem that there's tremendous opportunities to gain an advantage, some sort of advantage over others. But there might be also a huge, huge down possibility that we could be put in a very disadvantageous position. And the gains may be short term and may be a trick, and we may lose it all anyway. So I feel it's a very tricky market right now. And it's better to go neutral and say, I'm just not going to risk my money at all. So we're using a business money analogy that most people can relate to, especially in these modern times. And I think it holds up well to look at it this way. So it's quite possible that this will, you know, the acceptance will dawn upon me. My reason will say, hey, this is reasonable. Let's do this. This is very reasonable. And we don't have to say it's forever. We just say, let's do for the next 9 months. We feel that it could be, you know, just a really wild and woolly time. And if I'm worried about my money, my investment, my thoughts could be just pulled all over the place, and it may be just be too stressful for me. So I'm just not going to seek any advantagement, but also I'm going to make sure I'm going to protect myself from any disadvantage whatsoever. And I feel in such a good place I could do that. I don't really need really the idea of advantage. I don't really need it. I already feel that I'm already right there, you know, as far as knowing what I want to know. So it's better just to make sure you don't backslide. That's what's crucial here. So this may be possible. I'm asking for the grace to make this happen for me. All right. So I'm trying to set an example. That, you know, we want to get ahead of the situation. We don't want it to get on top of us. We want to get on top of the situation and steal a march on it. Now, many people, I believe, will be tempted into what seems to be a great opportunity when there's all sorts of turmoil. There's also seems to be tremendous opportunity, right, to gain an advantage over others. But I would say I really don't want to gain an advantage over others, actually. Nor do I want them to gain an advantage over me. I want it to be equal. I want it to be equal. So let's just stay in this sort of state of equal mind and just abide in that for the next 9 months. You know, what's wrong with that? I think that's very sage advice. So I'm feeling that there very well could be some sort of spiritual paradigm I could accept pretty easily now. And I'll say, okay, I'll get into this and let me just get used to this. Sneeze tried to develop and just dissipating it. You know, something's trying to sneeze at this idea, and I'm saying, no, I'm not going to let you sneeze at this idea. This is a very good idea. Egoic mind was trying to sneeze at this idea and shock me out of it. I say, no, you're not. I'm not going to allow that. So the people are busy partying, you know, and we're here looking at something extremely important, right? We are not partying here. There's very volatile people over there. Well, chaos, can you hear it? Very chaotic, very full of turmoil. All sorts of reactions taking place. But let's stop trading in reactions. Let's stop trading. Let's just stop trade in reactions. Stop trading in reactions. What are reactions, actually? Do we need them? I mean, do we need to judge God? Is God changing? I mean, is reacting, reactions, is that our abidance in God, or did God create us with a natural abidance that's not some sort of reaction? Do we really need, you know, reactivity to know our identity? Anyway, so we're very actively here, actively looking to pin down, get into a position here, a stable mind. In light of what is likely to transpire, after September 15th, you might say that this is that marks the beginning, so to speak, and then from that day forward, then 280 days, 40 weeks, takes us to June 21st, right up to June 22nd, 216. If ever there was a time to play it safe, this is the time. And I don't think many people would disagree with this in the world right now. Really. If ever there was a time to play it safe in your investment, now is the time. So we call upon all possible help right now to help us get us into this situation for the next 9 months, where we're just going to hang out in this mental state for at least the next 9 months, and we'll reevaluate it at that time. And we don't really have to fit it into anything classical or orthodox or do any of that at all. Let's just let the grace of God decide it for us. And all the help available, let that decide for us. We don't have to try and, align it with some sort of tradition or anything like that. Right? I mean, all we need is to see it the way that it works for us, to picture it the way that will be effective for us, be able to accept whatever it is we can accept. I'm not really too concerned about all the niceties of, well, did this teacher blah blah or this blah blah blah. I'm really unconcerned about that. Are you saying it in the correct orthodox way? And I'm not concerned about orthodoxy at all. I'm concerned about the real situation of potential severe instability in the world, and our importance to have a basic situation of mental stability. That's it. So I'm definitely calling upon all help right now. It is a full 5-alarm situation right now. I mean, the situation of going out to the golf course, which I hadn't done in a long time, on what seemingly being pushed out there, the circumstances, and suddenly was out there, and then it seemed like a war broke out on the golf course. I mean, the golf course is a place where you think it's going to be peaceful, right? So this is one incredible situation. On the back nine, on the 11th hole, 9-11, a wildfire suddenly started, and then you had these airplanes and helicopters and sirens, and it looked like a combat zone with these planes like bombing, These planes are like, remind me of 9-11, actually, to tell you the truth. There's this the clubhouse, and this huge plane was just headed like straight for it. I said, oh my gosh, it's too low, sighing so low. And it flew right over the top of the roof of the clubhouse, so that it could then, get real close to the fire and drop the fire retardant so it wouldn't disperse in the wind. Okay, this is why. But I mean, it looked like a 9-11 event, to tell you the truth. And I was out on a golf course, which was supposed to be a very peaceful, tranquil place, and yet all hell broke loose. So, we've just had this, there's this treaty with Iran, and people are going to proclaim, that peace, and the Pope and the President are supposed to get together on the 23rd to commemorate, it's going to be a big deal about, look, we finally, brokered this insanely great peace plan. Remember what they say, when they're saying peace, that's when you need to flee for the mountains. This is when trouble breaks out. Now, who's to say that there might be some severe reaction to this so-called peace accord or a false flag? Now, a false flag, of course, is, let's say, here's an example. Let's say you have a government and they have an enemy government. Okay, two nations don't get along. And one nation kind of wants to attack the other nation. And the people of the nation say, no, we're not really into that, we enjoy our peaceful times here. So what does the government do? They say, okay. So what the government does is it actually sets up a situation where it attacks itself. the government attacks itself, but disguises the attack to make it seem like the enemy nation has done the attacking. And then they go to the people and say, look, this enemy nation just attacked us. We cannot stand for that, can we? And the people say, no, we cannot. And then they say, we're going to attack this nation. Meanwhile, the other nation said, hey, wait a minute. We didn't attack you. What's going on here? This is unjust. This is terrible. But they get attacked. This is a classic politics. Classic politics. It's happened over and over in the world. Many say 9/11 was a false flag. I wouldn't be the slightest bit surprised if it was a false flag. And so, I certainly believe that there are those around the world who would employ a false flag situation. Absolutely. I believe a lot of people also believe the same, that in order to advance an agenda that the people don't want, they will simulate attack against themselves, blaming it on some, really dangerous people, and said, hey, we got to make adjustments and do in order to, strike back. And then the people then will be pulled in this direction, say, okay, yeah, we can't stand for being attacked by these people. Terrible. Classic false flag. Galvanizes. And some say that Pearl Harbor wasn't a classic false flag, but it was a false flag in that Roosevelt knew about it ahead of time. They had cracked the code. They knew about it. But because the American people didn't want to get involved in World War II, they didn't want to get involved. They were enjoying peacetime. Roosevelt said, hey, if I thwart this attack, then the people would just kind of maybe shrug it off. But if I allow the attack to take place, then the people will be absolutely infuriated, and they'll all be completely galvanized to fight World War II, so that he allowed the attack on Pearl Harbor to happen. There are some historians who believe that this is what took place. I wouldn't be at all surprised, not at all. Politicians at the highest level, like Roosevelt and the present mortician in chief, Mickey Mouse, M-I-C, mortician in chief, I call him Mickey Mouse. They are certainly not above this. In fact, these are cards that they are willing to play. There's no question about it. They fancy themselves as real movers and shakers, and a false flag for them, sure. They say, in order to be historically great, I need to make a historically great impact upon the world, and the population is too stupid to know what to do, so I'm going to do a false flag and galvanize them. Very possible. So we're in a window right now, I think, of great volatility. September, this going forward now, I think today is about what we've reached, the 6th, I think. Actually we're going to reach the 7th, would be tomorrow, and so 1 week takes us to the 14th. So we might have like 1 week. I don't know if something happened directly on 9/11. It might, with that golf course experience, this really got my attention. It was an ultimate attention getter, actually, because I realized, hey, I was meant to be there and to see this. The fact that I would be teeing off right at that time on that very golf course, extremely low likelihood of that happening, and yet it happened, and there was hardly anybody else around at all. It was just me and my playing partner there. We're just looking at this. Oh my gosh, there's a fire, a big fire, and I wonder if we're okay. And we're looking like, oh my gosh, should we even play, or what should we do? This is an attention getter. This is an extreme attention getter. I'm the right person to get attention onto this situation. Because I've been very much tuned into this and very much aware of the big picture of what's happening on this planet and what can we do about it. How do we sidestep it? How do we sidestep it? And it is time to sidestep it. So, we shouldn't be at all surprised if some of us begin to adopt this stable mind strategy, almost like an investment strategy, where we're not investing in thoughts anymore. Now, you know, the idea is we think that thoughts give us an advantage, right? There's an advantage and disadvantage to thoughts, and we think we can gain an advantage if we just think the right thoughts and those kind of this type of thing. But what about no thoughts? I mean, you know, you have no advantage or disadvantage there, would you? Pretty amazing consideration to disidentify with your thought cloud for a while. I'm seriously, you know, interested in this and aiming at this. And I believe my focus will pull the grace in necessary. This is what I'm believing in and aiming at. This is what I really want. Now, is this a reckless step? I would say to not do it is a reckless step. To not do it is to subject yourself to a great deal of recklessness in the world. I believe the world is an extraordinarily reckless place right now. With very naive people, very reckless people, a bunch of utopianists, and people of all sorts of persuasions, the way they've been indoctrinated, and I would say that they're not stable at all, reckless and lacking stability. So to subject ourselves, our mind, to this sort of turmoil is very, very stupid and reckless. So I would say it's a very wise step to go extremely to the side of things. If we look at progressivism of the cloud of thoughts, we would say then go to the right, go extremely to the right, where you're not investing in your thinking at all, or reacting at all. It's in the distance. You can still see that your thoughts are still functioning, but you've disengaged from them. You've disengaged from them. You've put them at a distance. And I believe there's some sort of grace within our mind that will enable us to do this. We just have to be willing to do it. And we wouldn't even have to call this enlightenment. We don't need to call it that necessarily. It's just that we have this stable, peaceful mind right now. We don't have to make a claim that's necessary enlightenment, do we? It's just taking refuge. You might say we're taking refuge right now. In a very stable mind, very stable mind, so that we're, you know, not subjecting ourselves to the volatility, the global volatility, right at this point. So it doesn't have to be, you know, directly linked into spirituality per se. Actually, you know, it's something that is more pragmatic. You know, this is a very pragmatic time. We have to be very pragmatic right now. So you might say, well, this is an exercise in pure pragmatism, which is spirituality. You could be said that that's exactly what it is. Actually, I view it, the Holy Spirit is very supremely pragmatic. This is what I've experienced, supremely pragmatic. It doesn't get hung up on any labels or tradition or orthodoxy or anything. It's just pure pragmatism. And so, to the Holy Spirit, reality is the ultimate... See, the Holy Spirit does not have a spiritual position in relation to reality. Reality doesn't have a spiritual position on itself at all. Reality is just the way that it is. It's all that there is. It doesn't see itself as being spiritual. It doesn't have self-reflectiveness like that. God doesn't say, well, you know, I'm really spiritual, as opposed to what? Non-spiritual? There is no duality to reality. So the Holy Spirit is not some religious spiritual force really at all. It's really pure pragmatism of how do we, you know, wake up from this dream of not being what we really are. So again, reality is not spiritual at all. Because it's not a duality of spiritual and non-spiritual. There's no such thing in reality. No self-reflectiveness in reality. It doesn't need it. So we don't have to literally associate spirituality with the condition of stable mind, really. We can say, well, both is and it isn't spiritual. I remember when I was abiding in reality for a brief time. I mean, I didn't think of labeling, well, this is spiritual, or this is this, or this is this. I just said, well, this is just the way that it is. This is home. This is how this is reality. And I felt very safe and stable there. Totally stable, totally safe. As if in all directions is an endless depth of quietude and undisturbedness. Nothing could cause a ripple or an impact upon me there. And everything was the same way. So I just said, ah, so this is my, you know, my true being. This is what reality is. But there was nobody saying, hey, isn't this really spiritual? This is really cool spiritual, man. This is very enlightened or something. There's nothing like that at all. So again, this is shocking as it may be. We might say reality isn't spiritual at all. We're the ones who are claiming it's spiritual from a standpoint of quote unquote non-spiritual. We're saying, oh yeah, reality is so spiritual. Yeah. And reality doesn't see itself that way. It doesn't have any self-image at all. God wouldn't know what you're talking about if you're talking this way, really. So the Holy Spirit just sees everything perfectly pragmatically. It doesn't work with, you know, in terms of, you know, labels and imagery and all this stuff in terms of, well, I got to be spiritual here. Like, is this spiritual? Holy Spirit, is this spiritual or not spiritual or everything? It's not tied up. It's not hindered in that way at all. So we would not have to define our condition in spiritual terms necessarily. And this is why I suggest we practice this, what both is and isn't. You know, because the ego will say, well, define your situation. And then we'll start to say, oh, I need to define it. Okay, what did Ramana Maharshi say? And can I say it like, what did Jesus say? Am I in this, you know? And the ego will say, well, wait a minute, is that exactly the right way to put it? Maybe you could put it in some other way, you know? And before you know it, you're locked into this dialogue and you've lost... you know, you've been distracted from where you are. So you just say, well, it both is and it isn't. It's both spiritual and not spiritual. You could look at it either way. And be not attached to either one. Because I think we're afraid the mind's afraid. So, well, what if I don't label it properly? You know, what if I don't see it, you know, spiritually enough or something. The Holy Spirit doesn't have any concern like that at all. It's not... Okay, this is a great relief as we can see it, the more we can see it this way. I don't have to be... Someone said, well, you must be a guru, you know, because you can say it and you can say it in this way or that way, or, you know, like you can quote the holy books this way and that way. Oh, okay, you must be very spiritual. We don't have to do that at all. Where are you? Well, I'm both here and not here. It's sort of like both being here and not being here. It's like you're both stable and not stable. And you know, there's both a perspective and not a perspective. I think that's the best way. It's the only way I can really express it. I'm not saying there's no position. I'm not saying there is. You know, in terms of expressing, you know, it's a both and neither kind of situation. It's both and neither. Also spiritual, people say, well, it's both and neither. It's both spiritual and not spiritual. It's both spiritual and not spiritual. Neither spiritual nor not spiritual. It's both and neither spiritual, I would say. You happy? Well, you know, both and neither there. What I experienced was that I felt infinitely inclusive, included there. Like there's no way I could ever get outside of this. There's no such thing as non-inclusiveness. So you might call it like immaculate inclusiveness, I would say. But you know, it's so inclusive you can't even come up with the idea of non-inclusive. So to express it, you'd have to say, well, it's both inclusive and not inclusive, if you're going to express it, because you would be damning it. You would be giving a wrong impression if you called it inclusive. You see what I'm saying? You would damn it with faint praise. So it's when you start getting talking with the ego, even if you use the most great positives possible, you actually will lead yourself into confusion as if you're damning your situation, because you'd be damning it with faint praise. So if you said, well, this is totally inclusive, that still, it doesn't even give, you know, doesn't give a indication of it really. So you would start undermining your experiencing, you know, like denying it, even with the most positive language. So this is why it's so tricky. The ego is so tricky in wanting to get us into discussions and talking. It's better to be silent. Who's asking to give an explanation is the question. It's the ego. We can abide in this easily, I believe. It's just that we feel we get tricked out of it somehow by having to comment upon it. I see a lot of people who said that they've been enlightened. Whoa. Did you hear that? Huge explosion there. Wow. I've never heard anything like that around here like that. That was different. Oh, gosh. Did you hear that? What is this? Holy cow. That's not fireworks. There's no fireworks today. Wow. Those are two huge explosions that just took place. But at any rate, I see people who were enlightened, and I don't say that they weren't. I'm not going to say that. I respect what they say. But they go around talking to people, and I can tell they're not abiding in it right now. Very interesting. But it's the ones who don't say much who continue their abidance in it. This is what I've noticed. Some of the great realized ones are quiet a lot of the time, mostly quiet. They don't say hardly anything. And when they do talk, they will say, well, it's both this and not this. It's this, it's not this, and it's both this and not this, and it's neither this nor not this. You know, they won't allow themselves to get pinned down, because somehow this undermines the experiencing. You cannot express the experiencing, because it's limitless. But as soon as we say it's limitless, we have a concept of limitless, and it's not that either. So it's both limitless and not limitless. See, this is how to talk about it. Good grief, those two explosions were huge. That was not like an M80. No way. Wow. Holy cow. That wasn't far from here. Shoot. Well, I'm not going to go look for where the origin of it. I heard what the origin is. It's Those weren't just kids having fooling around. Those were deeper and moved air in a different way than smaller ordnance, you know, firecrackers and M80s and various stuff like that. Those are big explosions. Good Lord. About 10, 12. Okay. My gosh. What's going on here? So I believe that what the ego tries to do is tries to talk you out of it. This is what I experienced when I was in this condition. I was fielding all these questions, like psychically, as it were. I was aware of all these questions people are questioning me. And I was responding in certain very appropriate ways to keep from being... And someone finally was able to hook me into, you know, in some way where I somehow lost track of where I was, you know, and got into the conceptual realm again, which I managed to get out of that conceptual realm. And I pulled back into it. I've been trying to get back ever since. So I believe that those who understand what I'm saying will certainly understand, you know, the talk of yes, it both is and it isn't. And some of you are actually using that talk now, which is extraordinarily good. Very, extremely helpful, because keep in mind, no matter what we say about reality, it's extremely damning with faint praise. Which it will subtly distract us from it, because then we have to back up what we said. No, wait a minute. Well, you said, someone will say, well, you said that, so that's what it is, right? And now, well, what do you think? And they'll try to, you know, pin you into a definition, pin you into a position of it. But if you see complete inclusiveness in all directions, you know, do you really have a position? Is it can you really say I have a position? Not really, because wherever you go, you've always already been there, so to speak. You know, it cannot really be explained with words. I'm surprised there's no sirens right now with those explosions. Very odd. Two explosions. Well, there you go. I mean, we're talking about, remember, I've been talking about it. I think there's going to be a double event in some ways. And we just had two explosions, one after the other. Twin Towers, two main hits on the, you know, and Pentagon was something else, something weird. But, you know, the main event was two Twin Towers, two explosions there. Our experiencing is quite extraordinary, isn't it? It's surreal. You know, you have to love it. And so, at some level, we love all this. You know, at some level, really. But at another level, we're all shaking with fear and instability. You know, don't. But it the synchronicities and everything. I mean, it just it's. If we saw it all as it really was, we'd probably just love it and say, "Wow, what a creative! You know, what amazing creativity! You know, and there'd be." Appreciation, you know, in an abstract way of it all. But here we are talking about this very issue, and two huge explosions rock the area near here, which is, I've never had this happen to me ever here. The timing of it is just too extraordinary to believe, you know, but it happened. The Holy Spirit told me to go out here and tape. So it's, you know, the Holy Spirit's coordinating, the perfect pragmatist, the Holy Spirit. Now, even when we say, the people ask, what kind of reaction did you experience with God or whatever, you say, well, even if you say, well, there was no reaction, that is still putting into a concept which isn't true. we say, well, there both was no reaction whatsoever and also not no reaction. Both no reaction and not no reaction, you would say. To simply say, conceptually, you cannot abide. You know, what the ego is trying to do is build up a concept of reality. So it thinks, oh, someone's experiencing reality, great. Help me build up a concept of reality so I can be happy. This is not the way, of course. So, will there be a false flag event before the president and the pope meet? I'd say would not be surprising at all. In order to put extreme attention on the meeting and even to rearrange the pope's schedule to spend emergency, you know, it could be emergency session of the UN council when the pope is there, and the president of course will join the pope at the UN UN's emergency council where they're actually going to draw up some sort of strategy, you know, to combat world terrorism or something like that, which, you know, and they'll put global warming, they'll try to, you know, to give them the juice to push something through. There could be a false flag event. So the whole world will say, please help us, do something, you're there together, come on, do something, the whole world wants you to do something, and which is exactly what they want the world to say. They'll say, gee, isn't this a coincidence that we happen to be meeting like this here in Washington, D.C., just after this terrible event took place, and you know what, it's a perfect time to do something about it. God has given us this opportunity. You know, the Pope will probably say something like that. You know, this is hypothetical, but you know it could happen. The Pope will say, you know, divine providence has put us here together, dear President, and destiny has been put in our hands, and it's up to us to respond to this, and God is of course asking us to respond. So the Pope will give religious credence to it, the Pope will be able to, you know, give the religious authority to the whole situation. Say, yes, we all, from the religious standpoint, I'm sure we all agree that you and I, we need to do something. We need to take destiny in our hands now and work together. And we need to, you know, pass some very important resolution, etc. Gravitas, the extreme religious gravitas. The Pope will supply that. And the President will supply the supreme diplomatic gravitas, statesmanship gravitas. The Pope fancies himself as this awesome force of God of humanitarianism to save the planet. And the POTUS fancies himself as this extreme, historically great statesman, bringing peace to the world. So the two of them together, you know, feel, you know, it's up to the two of us to take the lead and initiate a new global plan here. We can't have any more of this. You see that it's ripe for a false flag right now. It is very ripe for a false flag event. Which means the people who want this new world order to push through, you know, will be in cahoots with the president and the pope, so to speak, and they will set up a false flag event in order to give them the excuse they need to act. You know, and most people are not wise enough to see this, although a lot of people are now. I mean, for us, we probably just, of course, business as usual, of course, you know, we're not going to be confused by it or anything, not even going to react to it. If something like this happened, maybe by shedding light on this, it won't. We hope it doesn't, that's for sure. But they most definitely want to take the wind out of the sails of Mr. Trump. No question about it. they're just going to pull the rug out from underneath them. This would not be surprising at all. They're saying, hey, you know, this is a pretender. You know, we're the real McCoy. We're the heavyweights here, not this guy. And we're not going to let him have any say, any more say whatsoever. We're going to, you know, seize the moment, carpe diem. And we're going to proclaim a new world order where we're going to, you know, finally live in peace and harmony and get rid of all the troubles that are causing this terrible, you know, attacks around the world, whatever, you know, that kind of thing. And it'll be a great accord. You know, the whole United Nations is, it will be in session on the 15th they start, something like that. Interesting. So that gives a time to draft a resolution before the Pope gets here. You see that? Wow, the timing is extraordinary here. So the Pope is already scheduled to address the General Assembly of the United Nations after addressing a joint session of Congress, which is, the Pope has never done this before. So this is already scheduled. How convenient. How convenient. Perfect time for Congress to and the President and Congress get together and agree upon some radical legislation, and the UN to agree upon some radical program, and then the Pope come over and give it his benediction, you know, his benediction. It's like, yes, as head of 1.2 billion plus Catholics, and I absolutely agree. We agree that we're going to work together on this. You know. Various, yeah. Pope, you know, will give it this aura of religious benediction, like this is the will of God. Wow. Too many things have been happening for me to shrug this off. You know, those two explosions just were another astonishing synchronicity here. You know. Perfect setup for a false flag, a severe false flag. The Pope being here addressing Congress 24th, addressing the UN General Assembly like the 30th or the 28th, maybe, I think, something like that, gives them time to produce the resolutions. Then the Pope will give the resolutions his blessing, which will then spread out throughout the world, through all the bishops and the priests and the congregations throughout the entire planet, saying that this is, to all Catholics, we agree that we're going to go along with this. And then, of course, secular humanists, of course, all want to go along with it already. So you have this fusion of the secular humanists and religion taking place. Of course, there might be some roadblocks along the way. But don't bet against it. I wouldn't bet against it at this point. I wish against it. I hope against it. But I wouldn't place money right now betting against this. Not with the events that I've been experiencing. I mean, I'm sitting there taping and boom, something lands right above my head really hard. Like two rocks hitting hard, and then rolls off in double walnuts. But it hit real hard, heavy. Whack. Just when I'm taping it, just extraordinary. And it goes on and on and on, on and on and on and on. Two impacts, double impact in some way, double impact. And we just have those two explosions just rock this. I mean, this never happens here like this. No way. So, very peaceful place. This extremely peaceful place. Two explosions rock this. So we think we're in an era of peace now, the big peace accord. Like I'm on a golf course, suddenly a fire breaks out, no conflict breaks out. So we're thinking, oh, the Pope is coming. It's a time of peace in the world. You know, he's going to give his benediction and blessing to the POTUS. So you're a great peacemaker, a great statesman. What an awesome job you've done. You saved the world from war with Iran and blah, blah, blah. You know, all this is set up. Time of peace, and then suddenly in this time of peace, you know, kaboom, kaboom. Okay. If this is the case, we can expect the grace of God to be poured out upon us at this time. Absolutely, we can expect this. And I have been expecting it. Absolutely. And I believe this practice the Holy Spirit is giving out, which is both this and not this, is extremely important. This is how we can abide in this and not get pulled out of it. Now, we might get pulled out of it, you know, but there may be some in the world who do not get pulled out of it, and they can help us get back into it. This is what I'm hoping. You know, I know for a fact that we can get into this non-dual abidance in this perfect inclusivity and safety and stability of reality. I've done it. But I also know we can temporarily disassociate with this and not realize that we're there. And so we need to be able to get back to it. So if there were those in the world who do not get pulled out of it at all, they could absolutely help us get back into it. No question about it. So, you know, when I say that those people who have run spiritual retreats, say, I can give you enlightenment and this, blah, 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 you know, I say, you know, come on, okay, come on. But it would be possible at this time if you're able to get into this non-dual abidance and somehow you get ego talks you out of it. It might be possible if you go on a spiritual retreat or something like that, that you could be helped to get back into it. That is possible. So I'm giving a little wiggle room to, you know, to everybody, really. I'm not trying to pin anybody down and say they're right or wrong entirely. Just, you know, it's just sort of a general awareness of what may be possible. We get in the groove and then we slip out a little bit, we get back in the groove. Maybe there'll be retreat centers, I don't know, where those who are helping others might slip out of it, go back into these retreat centers and get able to be help themselves get back. I mean, be helped by great teachers, get back in the groove, and they can go out and then keep helping others get into the groove and stay there. And, you know, this is feasible. It's feasible. It seems like this, the time of like 9/11, 2/15, up through, you know, maybe the 17th, 18th, or 20th, or that there's a time right there in the mid September, which is a perfect time for a false flag situation to happen. Perfect time. It gives the U.S. Congress and President and the UN General Assembly time to draft, you know, to come up with an emergency declarations, and then the Pope arrives on the 22nd to give his blessing to these emergency declarations saying that the Catholic Church will cooperate. You see? This is essential. You know, you cannot have a new world order unless the Catholic Church cooperates. 1.2 billion people, very organized, you know, extraordinarily well organized and administrated over. They have to be on board. The Pope has to be on board. And there is some ecumenical dialogue going with the Eastern Orthodox, which is also important. Eastern Orthodox historically has been very important. You know, they would be good for them to go along with it too. So, perfect time. Perfect timing for a false flag. Perfect timing. And then that would give us exactly 280 days. Sneeze is trying to hit me real bad. Okay. Dissipated it. Trying to sneeze this away. Still trying. 280 days perfectly till bring us up to June 22nd, 2016. So the timing is all here. It's all here. And so is our timing to sidestep it. It's also here. Absolutely. I absolutely call upon, you know, all the grace right now. All great grace in every which way to support our sidestepping into this, you know, non-dual abidance. And we absolutely can use this technique. Well, it's both, you know, I'm both, you know, it's both stable and not stable. In other words, refuse to say anything definitive about it, really. Which would, as soon as you try to say something definitive about it, you're going to get pulled away from it, so to speak. You'll be unaware of it. There's nothing definitive that can be said about it, including, we would say there both is and isn't anything definitive that can be said about it. Because even when we say we can't say anything about it, that's also definitive, isn't it? So there's both. Can both say something about it and not say something about it. It's both definitive and non-definitive. Both totally definitive and both totally non-definitive. End of story. And they say, well, I don't understand. Well, it's not understanding we're after. It's abidance. They say, well, I can't abide if I don't understand. No. It's the opposite. As long as you're struggling to understand, you won't be aware of where you really are. Because where you really are is beyond understanding. Completely beyond what you would say understanding. You cannot conceptualize it. You both can and cannot. Now, the right mind understands this. Spirit understands this. Says, yeah, I understand. The ego can't get it. Thinks you're being funny or tricky or thinks of word games. It needs to argue. It needs to get in this debate, you know, discuss and figure it out. What's it? And this is all wrong. You cannot get into that. So it's better to be quiet. It's better to be quiet. And the Holy Spirit will understand this, and those who want peace of mind will understand this. They say, okay, I'm not here to discuss anything. I'm here to feel the peace that's available here. I want to get into that peaceful state of mind also. And I want to protect it from being pulled out of it. This is what we really want. So, we are here in the West Coast. We are headed for a big heat wave for this area. About 8 days in a row, it's going to be, you know, hot, you could call it. And you know, maybe five of those days, you know, probably 100 or more. Which, you know, I love heat waves. It's great. I'm very happy a heat wave is coming. Crickets will be out strong. I mean, evening time. You know, lovely. It's supposed to be like 64 degrees at a low at night. You know, like, so it's just very balmy at night. Crickets going all night. And there's something about a heat wave that it makes the world seem kind of surreal. I don't know. The whole world feels differently in a heat wave. Just love it. Everybody slows down, or should slow down. Of course, we don't anymore with air conditioning everywhere, but everything kind of slows down, which is great. People just, you see them just sitting, you know, they're not hustling and bustling. They just, I'm just going to sit here for a while. Not say anything, too hot to talk. So we're getting there, and we could just say to people, look, if I try to use, you know, express it, I'll get pulled out of it. I will lose track of it because I'll be, you know, damning it with faint praise, or you know, defining it with, you cannot define it. So I have to use, you know, these double expressions of both is and isn't, and you just have to get used to that as how I respond to it. And why it's important is that you learn how to do this too, so you can abide in it also, because you'll need to also protect your abidance from the ego trying to pull you into specifics and details and expressions and definitions and specifications and all this kind of stuff, trying to say, well, can't you at least, you know, express it positively? No, I can no more express it positively than I can negatively. Positive expressions are no closer to it than negative expressions, actually. So the ego will trick us into saying, well, I mean, you know, you should be able to at least express it positively. Is it good? Is it nice? And I say, no, I mean, I can't. It's both nice and not nice. It's both nothing and not nothing. It's both expressible and not expressible. Those who want to try to play games with this, you know, it's just, hey, it's time to hit the road. You know, we're not into playing games with this. This is important. This is not anything to mess around with. You know, it's tough love time. So we're not going to harbor any sort of disruptiveness at all. You know, it's not a game. But it is not just some silly game we're playing. This is extremely serious business here. And we are protecting our mind, as it were, from drastic turmoil, which will sweep us away from the realization we want. So we are going to protect our, you know, our abidance. And we're not going to mess around. And, you know, that this new tone will be evident in me, I think, going forward. You know, it's a new tone. It's time to get absolutely serious about it. And I'll do whatever I need to do to, you know, to set that tone. This is not a joke. I mean, this is not a trial run. This is the real thing right now. And this is what the Holy Spirit's trying to show me. You know, hey, you know, this is go time. This is go time. So, look at it that way. And I know a lot of you are. A lot of you get it. And but we will clarify and clarify until it becomes just kind of second nature to us, and just say, oh, this is easy, I get it. And yet we'll do it fast. So, a lot of tapings going on right now, and hopefully you have the time to watch these videos. Very important information here. All right, we're going to stop this one so I can get some rest and go at it again tomorrow. I'm sure it'll be even more intense tomorrow. This is just extraordinary what's happening. All right, very great. That's it for this.